Yeah, sis and tell, sis and tell. A whole lot of talk about a whole lot of nothing. Amanda does stand up, Allison's on TV. And when they hop on the phone, it's the place you wanna be. Sis and tell. Sis and tell.
Hey, Allie.
Hi, man. What's going on?
I'm excited for this podcast.
I know. Well, I preempted this by telling you, though, that I have a game we want to play, but we have to build up to the game because there's a reason behind it. And you'll love the topic that has inspired the game because it's music, right? And I know we are both huge music fans. You are a longtime Beastie Boy fangirl, aficionado. Yes. I grew up, you know, with things like U2 and Billy Joel and all of that.
Durant.
Yeah. And I was thinking the other day that when new songs come on the radio or, you know, the songs that are popular with our kids, I'm either, you know, dancing to it in the car or I'm singing along lyrics that I think I know, which I don't. And the boys are always calling me out. And I don't know if this happens to you too, but they're like, do you know what you're singing?
No, I never do.
No, and I don't either. And it's usually because I know some of it, but I don't really know the real lyrics.
And is it also like sometimes the lyrics are using jargon that like I don't know what it means too? I mean,
right.
I might be getting the lyrics correctly, but I'm using words like even like in modern day vernacular, like I didn't know that Netflix and chill, I didn't know what it really meant. Do you know?
Yes, I do know what Netflix and chill is.
It's like naughty, but, you know?
Yeah. Like, but let me tell you something. Alan and I Netflix and chill every night. And at 50 plus years old, let me be specific. We are really watching Netflix and chilling on the couch. Let's be very clear.
Oh my God.
And it is awesome.
You should not be Netflix and chilling with any family members other than your husband or wife or your partner.
Partner, yes.
Yeah. So
So part of it is I may not know the jargon. The other is I really just don't know the words. But they call me out on it mainly when it's a song that has inappropriate lyrics or innuendos, right, that I'm not catching because I don't even know what the lyrics are. They're like, do you even know what you're singing, right? Like, do you even know why you're, like, hopping around to this song? Like, you don't even know what this is. I'm like, oh, okay. Which is why I realize, like, some of the artists that I love the best, like Billy Joel, the Beatles, right, these songs, I probably know hundreds of songs when it comes to like Billy Joel and the Beatles and
it's clean music.
And clean music that I understand and I know the lyrics to. Even Queen, right? Like I know the lyrics, like Bohemian Rhapsody's pretty fast, but I can pretty much sing that whole song. The ones I grew up on that I know, and they're stuck in my head and they have taken up my hard drive, right? I can't figure out anything else. And I did think maybe it's just the new music, right?
Even the older songs. Like there's phrases in there that not until recently did I know what they meant. Like She Bop, Cyndi Lauper's She Bop. You know what that is referencing, which y'all can just look that up. But
no, I don't even know. No.
You don't know?
No.
Okay.
Okay. Well, don't tell me on
I'm
the air
because
I'm
going
to have to bleep you out.
It feels
like it's naughty.
But my kids, when they were little, I was listening to Salt and Pepper Push It and I, which is obviously about sex, but not to them. I told them it was about pooping. So.
Which it could be. It could very well be. Well, this brought me, you know, all these times where I thought, well, I don't really know the lyrics or I didn't understand the lyrics. I said, it's because it's this new age music and or the genre of music. But
new age.
I sound so old. Oh. It's this new music.
It's new age. New age is like wind chimes in it.
I know. I feel like a scene out of Back to the Future. Oh, this rock and roll music is too much. But all of a sudden, I had an epiphany the other day because we were driving and a song came on, a song that is old, like from the 80s old. That's old. And I realized I knew the song and I couldn't understand one word of the lyrics. And I started laughing out loud because the title of the song was actually the chorus, so I sort of knew that. But even if I didn't know the title of the song, I'm not sure I would have understood any of it. So then it made me think, oh my gosh, Amanda's much better at this than I am, because I think you your ear is a little better. And I thought, I wonder if she knows the actual words to some of these songs. So what I've done is I have curated, I've gone through and I have curated three different genres, basically, okay, from three different artists and songs that I'm certain you have listened to, like, at least over and over. The first song is the one I actually heard on the radio, okay? And this is not like a gotcha. I'm going to tell you the artist and I'm going to tell you the song, but okay, you cannot Google the lyrics, okay? Fair enough? All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to play...
I'm going to do so bad.
You're, I know.
I think you're better than I am at,
okay,
this.
And it might be a little long, but, you know, if you get some of it. So I don't know if you have a pen and paper. I don't think that'll help you, but to write down what you think it is.
Hold on. Hold on one second.
Okay.
Okay. I've got not only paper and a writing utensil, but I have a clipboard.
Okay. So hopefully you can hear this. And listen, I'm just going to do the very first, like, paragraph.
Are you going to tell me the artist?
Yeah, yeah. So we're going to go. So the first song is by Blondie. Okay, you know Blondie? Heart of Glass. As soon as you hear this song, and I'm sure people like that are listening are like, okay, I got this, right? This is, and, you know, my dream is to be on a game show. So now I'm just going to host our own podcast game show. Okay, Blondie. Heart of Glass. If you're listening at home, do not Google, because that's cheating, okay? And I'm going to just play the very first, like, few lines of the lyrics, which I'm looking at the lyrics. I still am laughing because I have no idea what they're saying. Okay, you ready?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Okay. What you got?
Oh God. I'm about to pass. And then something. I've got some gas. I got a Heineken. And then something. Heart of Glass.
Okay, good. That. Good. So Heart of Glass is in the lyrics. You got some of that right. Here's that.
Is there gas or pass?
What? You ready? Here are those first four lines. Once I had a love and it was a gas, soon turned out had a heart of glass. Seemed like the real thing only to find mucho mistrust, love's gone behind. That's not what I've heard. Yeah, there's no way.
You cannot understand her. That is a song that is classically difficult to understand.
Yeah, yeah.
So there, I don't think anyone could understand that unless that's your karaoke song.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That is impossible. I have no idea any of those lyrics.
No.
Those are nice lyrics.
But those are nice lyrics. All right. So you sort of failed on song one, which I'm not surprised, right, because that's impossible. All right. This next one is a classic, right? I'm going to say that. This is Elton John. You know Elton John, right? Yeah. And I know you're thinking, oh, I got this. This is Benny and the Jets.
Okay. Give me a second, because my pen is not working and I can't write fast enough. So I'm pulling up pages.
Okay.
Just give me so I can.
So you're going to try to type while you're listening.
I'm going to try it. I'm a really fast typer.
Okay, good. All right. Are you nervous?
I am nervous.
And okay, those of you listening at home, Benny and the Jets, Elton John, do not Google it. I'm going to do the first stanza. Okay. You ready?
Yes.
All right.
Oh, there's no way. don't even know if I would understand that without the cheering. The cheering was made it, I think, a little more difficult.
Okay, fair enough. Should we play the second paragraph? You think you'll get that one instead?
Is there still cheering?
Yeah.
I can tell you I'm not going to understand it. And I got, hey, kid, tape me together while we're under the weather. Stick around. You got some hair and you got some sound. That's all I got.
All right. That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
No.
So here are the real lyrics. Ready? Hey, kids, shake it loose together. The spotlight's hitting something that's been known to change the weather. We'll kill the fatted calf tonight, so stick around. You're going to hear electric music, solid walls of sound. Yeah.
What is a fatted calf?
I don't know. But it really is like, it also reminds us that these songwriters are, you know, they're poets, right? Like the lyrics are really, once you really delve into the lyrics, you've got something that's truly sort of poetic. With that said, I'm going to pivot to something that sort of goes against that whole theory. This last one, I know you've heard before. And if you know any of the words here besides the actual like title of the song, I'm going to be very impressed. This is, it's funny that you brought up Shebop by Cyndi Lauper, because I'm going to play for you Mbop by Hanson. You know this song?
Mbop. No, that's a Salt and Pepper also do. Mbop. But yeah, Hanson, yes.
Mbop. Da-ba-da-boo-bop. Do-do-do-do-do-bop.
Yes,
all that. Okay, you ready? Right. So this is the lyrics. I don't know if anybody even knows what they are. Yeah, no, this
TLC is Mbop. Never gonna get it. No, who sings Never Gonna Get It?
Never gonna get it, never gonna get it.
Never gonna get it, never gonna get it, never gonna get it. That's how I feel what's gonna happen with these lyrics.
You're never gonna get this. Yeah.
I'm never gonna get it.
Okay, so this is Mbop by Hanson, an oldie and not such a goodie. Know this part, right? Sing it together.
Mm-bop, bop, 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 mm-bop. I'm not singing that. Sorry, no. That goes against. Everything.
That's the only part I know. They were so cute. I'm looking at their album. All right, what you got?
So first of all, I can't tell if it was distorted because I was listening through your phone through the computer.
Yeah.
Or if it's really, is it really that hard to understand?
It's really that hard to understand.
Why would you produce a song like that? I don't even understand.
But you remember how popular it was. It was a very popular song because
people
just cared about the Mbop.
You know what it was? It was also that the CDs used to come with all the lyrics.
Right.
So you could listen while you were reading the lyrics, and then it made sense.
Well, Alan keeps saying he wants his screen on his car to do karaoke so that when he's driving, whatever songs on the radio will come up. I try to explain to him that's like the most dangerous thing of all. He's distracted enough with his phone. All they need is like, sir, why did you run into that pole? Well, I was doing car karaoke, so I'm really sorry. All right, you ready? Okay, the first few words.
James Gordon. What's that guy?
Yeah, James Corden, the next James Carpool Gordon's Karaoke. Yeah.
Wait, you mean tell you what I
heard? Oh, wait, what did you hear? Sorry.
I heard, oh, yeah, yes. Baby gone too fast, maybe. Some kill it, babe, maybe. Did I get anything?
Oh, you did. You got quite a bit. I'm impressed. Okay, so it's oh, yeah. You have so many relationships in this life. Only one or two will last. You go through all the pain and strife, then you turn your back and they're gone so fast. Oh yeah. And they're gone so fast. Yeah. oh, so hold on, the ones you really care, in the end, they'll be the only ones there. And when you get old and start losing your hair, can you tell me who will still care? Can you tell me who will still care?
So here's what's confusing about these lyrics. Who are they talking to about losing hair? Because aren't they...
Right, they're like 12.
Right? And they're like, aren't they singing to women or girls like their age?
I don't know.
Like teen heartthrobs.
Maybe they're singing to their fellow, their peers, right? Have to find somebody who's going to care about you even when you're bald. The reality is, like, I would love, I'm sure this has been some sort of SNL spoof, but that if you took lyrics like Hanson's lyrics, though, and then gave them to, you know, someone like an Amanda Gorman, who then made it like spoken word, like, could she transform even the worst lyrics? And I'm not suggesting Hanson has the worst lyrics. They're not terrible. They're not terribly good either. But like, in a different context, right? Like in a different genre, a different artist, a different narrator. Could it transform their meaning? It's pretty...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I think it could.
Yeah. But here's the reality is, I'm going to stop beating myself up for not knowing the lyrics to any songs, because even the ones that you know, I've known for decades, I still don't know those lyrics. I have no idea. I couldn't tell you any of those. You did pretty good. You did pretty well.
I have to say that, and even though I'm a huge Beastie Boys fan, I have to look at the lyrics in order to understand them. There's really only, and I know a lot of them, a lot of it's easy to understand, but to memorize, I really have to look at something to memorize it. Yeah. And that's just how I learn.
Right. Like there's like the REM songs. You know, that they just, some of those songs just go really fast, but you can understand them. But I remember being in my car, and because my school was 30 minutes from our house, right? So when I got my license eventually, I would literally use that 30 minutes to figure out the lyrics to the songs I love the best, which is how, like, especially like Bohemian Rhapsody, right? With Queen and other songs, I would just rewind and rewind, you know, the tape deck. I would rewind and rewind and rewind, and then I would sing along until I couldn't sing along anymore. And then I'd do it again, right? I could have used that time to actually like record some of my history notes or Latin quizzes and use that time to study that. In
or memorize a soliloquy from Shakespeare. What I did that with Jill and I would go to Memphis all the time in high school to go visit friends. And we spent 4 hours memorizing Dave Matthews, The Ants Go Marching, or whatever that song is called. You know that song?
Oh.
We wake up in the morning. Go to sleep, bite to eat, and we're snoring. I don't know the lyrics anymore.
But that Dave Matthews, the intonation, you've got down pat, yes.
Right, yeah. That song, Dave Matthews, wherever he is. He's still performing, right?
All right, so how did you like our first Sis and Tell game show?
That was fun.
We have no parting gifts. We have no prizes for you.
I didn't win anything. But, you know, I like being a game show contest participant. But I would rather be your co-host. I would be a good sidekick with you as the main host. I
hate to break the news to you. You are the sidekick, and I am the main host. Welcome to Sis and Tell Podcast. After almost 4 years, I should probably break the news to you. No, actually, I am more the sidekick. People often say, like, because you come across far more outrageous than I do and funny. I'm really the straight person, the straight woman. So I am the Ed McMahon to your Johnny Carson many days.
It's funny though, because I explain to people that you end up being the straight man in this situation, but you're not. You're really not. And like, unless you're with me, you're the funny weird one. That's just how weird I am, that I make you, I'm so weird, I make you into the normal one.
Right. Well, I think also people think I come across more as judgy than serious. They're like, yeah, we love your reaction when your sister will say something. You're like, yeah. I said, well, you don't even see my face. That would really do it.
Half the judgment.
Right. That's half the judgment is in the look. And they don't even get the benefit of that. So
Terminator judgment day every time we record. Right. No, but like you do weird. Like, look, I know I might have a series of videos where I'm dancing in a banana costume to various music that I obviously don't know the lyrics to. But you did that before me, not with a banana costume, but when like planking All was big.
Right.
You were taking pictures all over Chattanooga with Alan in the background, like eating Chick-fil-A while you were laying on tables, planking, like in the middle of a mall food court.
Yeah. Well, and I think for people, especially in Chattanooga, who know me, they know that I'm outgoing, but they don't know that my comfort zone is really pretty far outside of myself, right, on a normal basis. So most of the things I do are within a context of sophistication or professionalism. But if I'm asked, I'm happy to expand that, right, and do something, you know, quirky or, right, I did one of the first events I hosted virtually when COVID first hit. We had this woman who lives in town, who she is, she's a comedian. I actually ended up going on a hike with her with some friends. And when I saw her, I'm like, oh, you're Brandilyn Shropshire, aren't you? She goes, wow, you know my whole name. I was like, you are hilarious. She did this YouTube video. If you Google like mother in shower cap, whatever, and she's doing, what is she saying? Dear Lord, please make sure, like this whole thing about homeschooling and everything. And she's in a shower cap and big glasses, and it went viral. I mean, millions of hits. And so she's from Chattanooga, and we ended up having her on this virtual fundraiser. So after we showcased her, they came back to me, and I was wearing a shower cap and big glasses. And they're like, oh my gosh, we can't believe you did that. I'm like, I'll literally do anything for a laugh. If it's clean, right? Yeah. I will do anything.
No, you
anything.
Won't. You won't do anything. You just stated that you won't.
No. But I said if it's clean.
If it's clean.
Yeah.
Okay.
No,
you
I'm not going to be raunchy.
More,
yeah.
We're both risk takers.
Right.
But your risk taking is more a physical thing. I'm physical gags. You're like fit. Like you will jump off a building. You've literally scaled down a building.
Right.
A fundraiser, right? You'll do anything also if it raises money for an organization
right.
that you support.
That's it. Like if it's to fight for social justice, just throw me down the building or out the window. Literally. I mean, I will. Well, I don't really have a fear of heights. So some of the things, that's what I'm saying. Like some of the things that people are like, I can't believe you did that. I'm like, no, it was really fun, right? Scaling the building.
I'm like overly cautious when it comes to anything like that though. So, but I'm also, and I don't think you get accused of this, but I do all the time. And this is where my comfort zone is so far off from what everyone else's is that people always think that I'm drinking or I'm drunk.
Like even in the middle of the day.
Because I'm so outgoing and I do these things and people, like I will happily do karaoke without drinking anything. That's just fun to me. And I'm one of the best experiences I had was doing karaoke with a live band. It was called Mr. Miyagi.
What?
That was
That is so much fun.
They did. It was like an 80s cover band. Like I'm sure they moonlighted as like an 80s cover band, and they did live band karaoke. So if you whatever you were singing, if they thought you needed help, they would come in as your backup singers and help you with the lyrics. Like if you were off tempo or you dropped the words because you were nervous, they would come in and sing with you. And I've always wanted to be in a band. And I'm a performer. I'm not a singer. Right.
Right.
But that was like the best of everything. But I cannot tell you how many people have come up to me. And this has been since I was young and been like, I met you. You must have been so drunk. And I was like, no, I actually hadn't even had anything to drink.
Right.
I just have, and it's not like I'm trying. I'm not being brave because it's not scary to me. Being brave is doing something despite being scared of it. And so it's not.
Right. As John Wayne once said, you know, I love my quotes. courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is being scared to death and getting on the saddle anyway.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
So for me, I'm like, woohoo.
Yeah. There is that. I often say, though, the older we get, the fewer opportunities I think we engage in that puts us truly out of our comfort zone, where we get that fear, right? Like if you think about like the spelling bee in third grade or the first presentation you did in front of the class or even, you know, like a job interview, like those firsts in our life that we felt on stage, even if we weren't on a physical stage, but that the spotlight was on us and that there was a lot riding on our answers, the way we presented ourselves and just that uncertainty. And I think as you get older and more experienced, those butterflies tend to dissipate. But we also start to, I don't know, we start to just focus our attention on the things we know we're good at. So even though I might say, oh, I'm my comfort zone's pretty wide, I do, some of the things I do are sort of repetitive in nature. So I keep doing the same things that are possibly outside other people's comfort zone, but repeatedly within mine. So I think it's important that we always sort of challenge ourselves to say, okay, so what is outside of our comfort zone? What's something that either physically or mentally or socially we really wouldn't choose to do, but when we do it, we know we grow. And that's right. That's every year. It's a challenge. I hope I do. It is hard. It is hard.
I guess for me, it would be joining a book club.
To actually read. I know. You are so funny. You never read. But you'd love it. It's such a gift.
Yes.
I'm going to tell you. You know who's listening right now? One of our super fans.
People who read.
One of our super fans, Selena, who is this amazing teacher. She was our kids' teacher. And she is like one of the most dedicated, creative souls in the world. And I love her. And I got to see her in passing the other day. And she wrote us that Sis and Tell has really been just a lifeline for her. And she has been a lifeline for me for so many years. And Selena would tell you right now, she's a voracious reader. And she encourages her kids and her students to read. Just pick up a book, because once you start, I promise you, if you get into a book and you get, just give yourself 50 pages, right, to really just get engaged with the characters, it will be better than Netflixing and chilling. I'm telling you, you're gonna be able, and let me tell you, you'll be able to book and chill alone.
Okay, just because you're Netflix and chilling the wrong way, okay?
I'm telling you, try to book and chill. Book and chill, baby.
Look, I read all the Harry Potters, okay?
And
ignored my husband the entire time.
See?
There's no chilling. But he was like, please pay attention to me. He couldn't understand. He's a voracious reader.
Yeah,
he does love reading. He reads just constantly. So he could not comprehend what this Harry Potter series was. And this is, of course, when it first came out. So he tried, I'm like, read it with me. And he couldn't get past chapter one in the first book. And when the last book came out, that's when he decided to pick it up again. But he only picked up the last book, and that MF-er read the last two pages of the last book.
No, he did not.
Yes, he did.
That's rude. That's just rude.
That's so rude. I was like, I cannot believe you just did that. He goes, well, I know what happens.
Tell your husband he is going to be the person who shall not be named from now on. That is party foul, man.
I know.
But if you loved Harry Potter, that's a great example, right? And I read Harry Potter as an adult. I think there's probably so many people listening to this right now are going, yep, I read it. I read it before my kids. I stole the book from them, right? Passed it down to them, or read it with them, or read it two times. That's one of those classic examples of a book that is great for generations, for people of all ages, and you get sucked in. Like, there are so many different ways to get sucked in by a book, fiction and nonfiction. Just gotta try it.
My issue is,
pick up one.
I need to find a fantastic book series like that before it's made into a movie.
Yeah.
Because once it's a movie, I'm like, well, I'm gonna just watch the movie, right? Like, I wish I had watched stuff like, and I love like all of like the Lost World movies, the Jurassic Park movies, which were books first, right? Weren't they?
Yeah,
those were books first. I wish I had. You know, it's all that sort of,
well, and Handmaid's Tale, fantasy. that was books, and they're all.
Yeah.
But I, you know, and anybody listening to this who also loves to read will also tell you though that don't watch the film first, because it'll ruin it for you. The book is so much always so much better than the movie.
Right.
And the movies are good. Well, I like to watch the movie after I've read the book just to see. But the first time the boys did that, I think with, what is it? The
Hunger Games?
No, not the Hunger Games. Now that this is a new game show. The one, Lord of the Rings.
That's impossible. So I also love The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings.
Yes.
I tried reading that book. I really did. And there are just too many names. It was so confusing.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't even tell you. And I've watched that movie, that trilogy, so many times, both The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings, and I could not name one character except for Sam, who was the guy who was in. I don't even know. Frodo. Look, that's about it.
Well, I think Arthur's
Dobby,
the one who read
that's Harry Potter.
No, that's Harry Potter. I think Arthur was the one who read the trilogy, and then he watched the first film, and he was beside himself about everything that they left out, and he was just incensed. He's like, and then they skipped from here to here, and they never showed this. I go, you're now realizing why a book is so precious, because a movie cannot do justice to what the written word can do, right? And it's like, I love films just like the rest of you, but it's a different genre. So you have to give it different, you know, expectations versus a book.
Right. Just whatever you do, don't make me watch a movie with subtitles, because then we just can't.
That defeats the whole purpose, right, of watching.
Yeah. You would think that would be a good compromise, but it's not.
Oh, gosh.
So tell us about the lyrics that you have mixed up in your favorite 80s, 90s to now songs. We'd love to hear from you. Email us, sisters@sisintel.com. Facebook us, send us a message. But as always, don't forget to share us with your friends and family.
Thanks for listening to Sis Intel Podcast. As always, this has been Amanda and Allison with a whole lot of talk about a whole lot of nothing. We'll catch you next time.